to church this morning. It's great to have you with us. We're celebrating a new series as we kick off our wilderness series today. We're also remembering that yesterday was Anzac Day, and we're taking a moment even now just to thank God for those who have given their lives in much the same way as Jesus did to give us a chance at freedom and life here in Australia. And so we're going to include Anzac Day in our prayer this morning as we begin. Just before we start, we wanted to let you know that we're hoping to have a time of prayer and celebration live on Facebook before church at around 10:30 every Sunday. So if you're interested in joining our prayer, or you haven't had an opportunity to post some celebration news that you want to share and invite us to pray, then we'd love you to post on Facebook and we'll be praying for that, and you can join along with prayer before the service every week at 10:30. We're really grateful for the offerings that you are giving online. We know that this makes a huge difference to the ministry of the church. We're continuing to do what we can while we're online. We're running our youth groups online, our kids clubs online, and our community meal continues to be run. It just becomes a takeaway, and so this week we shared out a whole bunch of takeaway meals on Monday to our local community. Your offerings make a huge difference to our capacity to continue to do mission and ministry in the community. So we want to thank you for it. We want to encourage you to keep doing that. And if you haven't got the banking details and you're keen to get involved, just check out the website and you can follow the prompts so that you too can give your offerings online. We're really looking forward to worship this morning and hope that you've got yourself ready, up and awake, ready to worship God this morning and to draw near to Him. And we hope that as you worship this morning, you'll have an experience of being connected, even though we're the scattered church. So let's have a word of prayer before we begin. Father, we're so grateful for your presence in our life, and we acknowledge that every step of the way you are with us, just as you promised you would be. And even as we think about the week that's gone, we can think about moments where you've turned up, moments where you've showed us maybe something we've been looking for, or you've helped us out with decision making, or you've given us a wisdom or a moment or a word of encouragement. Lord, we are so conscious that so often we miss your presence in our lives, but you are active all the time. And we just want to take a moment to thank you, for your love, to thank you that you are ongoingly drawing near to us and walking with us through this time, that you are answering our prayers, that you hear our heart and you wipe our tears, that your love is for us. And so we just want to praise you this morning in our prayer. We want to give thanks for the times that you have done things in our lives so that we can enjoy and have abundant life. And we want to offer you our thanksgiving. And Father, as we have our worship service this morning, we open our hearts to you afresh. And we worship you. And we lift up your name. And we want to fix our eyes on you, the author and finisher of our faith. In these moments too, we want to give thanks for those who have sacrificed their life. Back 100 years ago, as the Anzacs, we want to thank you for their willingness to defend and protect and to serve, even though it cost so many of them their lives. And we want to thank you for the freedom that we have, the freedom to live, to love, and to laugh. And God, we give thanks for those that have given their lives. And we pray that we might pay forward the generosity, the kindness, the love, and the servanthood that they showed us, that we might pay it forward to the next generation. So we pray these things in the name of Jesus, our Saviour and Lord. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hello everyone. Since you're all stuck in your homes, I thought I'd bring you communion from my own house today. I have some thoughts around a song, some patterns in my life, the Bible, and of course, Jesus and his sacrifice. The space we're in may feel very different to anything we have experienced in our lives. A lockdown certainly isn't a common thing, and you might be completely caught off guard and feeling lost in a strange and unknown time. That's how I expected to feel, lost in a new pattern of life that I've never experienced. And strangely enough, for someone who works with people, is often around groups, energized by being around people and keen for adventure, I've been mostly okay in this space. I've had my ups and downs, but overall, it's been alright. And this is because, once again, I found God to be faithful and constant. In a way, I've experienced parts of this before. Have I run out of certain types of food? Yep. After moving out of home, it was quite the learning curve, knowing when and how much to shop. Have I run out of toilet paper? Yep. We've all been there. And suddenly, the least creative people become creative masterminds. Not being able to serve and work as normal? Yep. I've ruined my fair share of ankles and toes, and found myself unable to get up to my usual antics. Being concerned about getting sick, or my loved ones getting sick? Yep. Being stuck in one place for an extended period of time? Yep. I was quite unwell as a kid, and I spent a fair amount of time in hospital, often for a week or two at once. And to my surprise, I've been able to draw on my experiences in my life to know how to continue on in this time. And I wonder for you, what can you draw on that you have experienced that is similar in this time? In each of the times that I talked about, there has always been a way to keep going in a changed environment. And always, God has been there and has been faithful. In times of fear and being stuck, I have seen God's faithfulness. I've been reminded of a song by Elevation Worship called Do It Again. And I encourage you to listen to it and to dwell on the words. Some of them are, your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. I know that the night won't last. Your world will come to pass. Your word will come to pass. I've seen you move. You move the mountains. And I believe I'll see you do it again. In the hardest of times in my life, I've been able to survive and thrive. God has walked, stood, and ran beside me whenever and wherever I've been. In his word and his way of life, I've received fuel and strength. I've been able to draw on what I have seen to give me strength in this time. It is not only my story that I find hope in. The Bible is a rich and deep resource that is ready for us to draw on and find courage from. It is full of stories of exile and freedom, brokenness and remaking, famine and harvest, sickness and miracles. Whenever we are experiencing and whatever we are experiencing, we can find a parallel in the Bible, and there we will find that they are stories of hope, love, and restoration. There is no greater example of love, hope, and restoration than in the story of Jesus' sacrifice. It is here we see the greatest love, to die for all people, to save them from their sins. And it is here we see restoration and hope, that death is not the end, and that we can continue to choose a better way. When we eat the bread and drink the juice, we do so in remembrance of Jesus and what he gave so that we can live. We take time now to remember and reflect and to remake that choice to live a better way. After all, this is an everyday choice to say sorry for the bad and to recommit to the right way. I invite you now to take communion. And we do so together in spirit. In Luke we read, taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took the bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. As you go this week, spend some time considering how God has prepared you for a time such as this, and dwell in the Bible stories of hope, and restoration. Will you pray with me? God, here and now, we feel your presence. When we reach out, we know that you are there. We ask that as we continue on in a time that we didn't expect to find ourselves in, that we can draw on your hope and your love and your restoration. Give us the wisdom and the strength to see the path that we've walked before and how it's prepared us for now. And where we can't, Lord, let us turn to your word. Let us always turn to your word as we find in that place the hope that we need. Give us strength, Lord, to keep going and to look out for others and for ourselves and our families. Thank you for this time that we can spend together apart. We commit this day to you and all days to you. Amen.
Now and forever, God.
Today we have with us the cast from Inside Out. We're very excited to hear from you about how you're coping with the coronavirus situation, with self-isolating and getting through this tough season. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Hi. Good morning.
Morning. Hi.
It's great to see the cast back together again, and we really do appreciate you coming on the show and sharing with us your expertise in emotions during the coronavirus time. There's a lot of changes happening at this time. So how are you all coping?
Well, you know how it is. We have to make the best of the situation, and I am looking for the silver lining. I can walk my dog more, I can read books I've wanted to read for ages, and I can relax in my home. So many things to be thankful for.
Ugh. Being stuck inside drives me crazy. I decided to have a clean out in my house, so I've been clearing out all the junk. It's gross. I found upper claws under my bed, a furry cup of something I drank 3 months ago, and 15 left socks. This goes on much longer. I will go insane.
Well, actually, I haven't been doing much to pass the time. Like, I go for a walk, but then I think of all the germs outside, so I really don't get far past the front door, to be honest. You know, it's like a war out there. So I've been trying to, you know, just read a book and, yeah, I don't know, I'm a bit afraid that I'm not using my time as efficiently as I could, but, yeah, I put the book down, I go to watch the news, and I try to be across everything, like I'm following the statistics. You know, we want to flatten the curve and all this sort of stuff, but, yeah, I don't know, then I just end up hiding under my covers for a while because it's all a bit much, really.
What war? Don't be ridiculous. That's not war. It's just germs. That word can't stop you from doing things. Look, I still have to do things. Like, I can't sit around all day waiting for someone to give permission to do things. Sitting around makes me irritated, and being irritated makes me angry. I have to do something with that anger. I hate being stuck inside. I hate having nothing to do.
Perhaps some exercise would help anger.
How am I supposed to exercise when I'm stuck inside?
I'm not angry. I just feel sad. I can't see my friends. I can't have play dates with anyone. And I can't do all of the things I love, like going to school or eating at my favourite cafe. I wish everything was back to how it was.
Sounds like you're all experiencing things very differently in regards to isolation. So tell me, how are you socialising now that you can't catch up with friends in the same room?
Well, for me, it means that I can lose some of the friends that I didn't really want to hang around with, you know? Not going to school at the moment means that the groups of people I have to see, I don't have to see right now. And that's a good thing. There are no U8 boys in my house, so I don't have to put up with their brains rewiring at my expense.
Well, so I'm Zooming people to try to stay in touch, but, you know, it's not exactly the same. And I don't even know if my friends will still be my friends when things go back to normal, whatever normal is. Yeah, I just don't know. I hate seeing myself on the screen on Zoom. You know, you always get the angle that looks like right up your nose, and you can't see yourself. And yeah, I'm just afraid that people don't want to Zoom me because I just always look this way. I don't know, like, do I always look so crazy? I didn't realise until I started Zooming all the time.
Don't be silly, Fear. We all love you. It's great to develop new ways of doing things. Keep your mind learning. Use it or lose it. I love Zoom. I love FaceTime and Messenger. I'm having a ball joining all sorts of groups online. I joined a book club, virtual youth group, and choir. There are so many ways to make new friends at the moment.
As I said, I'm having trouble with friends. Not all of my friends are on Facebook and Zoom, and so I have to write to them with pen on paper. It's sad because not everyone writes back. I check the letterbox every day, but none. I also really miss hugs. I wish we were allowed to have hugs. I can't get through the day without them.
Oh, sadness, I'm sending you a virtual hug right now online.
Hey, isolation's hard for me too, you know. I like to have robust discussion and debates and rant and rave. That's what gives me happiness. But being on my own, there's no one to yell at. In fact, The other day I spent 20 minutes in the mirror yelling at myself just to make myself feel better. There's a lot to say, so much to think about, so much to just want to vent and scream. Don't get me started about toilet paper, hand sanitizer, flour, sugar. It just gets me so agitated. And then there's the whole American president. Let's not get started on him, otherwise I get really, really fiery. And sport reruns. I've seen the games a million times. I can't need new sport to watch.
Okay, all right. Well, thank you for sharing. That about sums up how you feel about socializing in isolation. So now, let me ask you a theological question. Since our audience is church-based, where do you think God is at work in the suffering? Is he home or is he absent?
I can tell you where he isn't. He isn't the one causing this suffering. No, God's not doing this. He's not at fault. He's not punishing the world. He doesn't have a big stick out there trying to hit people. The virus isn't God's work at all. It's just part of the broken world we live in. You know, people want to blame God and blame.
All right, Anger, thank you. I can see where you're coming from. But when we don't blame God, then who do we blame? The government? The nation? Where it all began? What do we do?
Blame. I mean, it's a hard thing. Like, everyone wants to blame someone, but it's not a blame game. You can be angry. Hey, and I love being angry. But there's no one to blame. We can be angry because our circumstances aren't right and things aren't going the way we want it to go. We don't have to hurt people because we're angry. We don't have to use our anger as a weapon.
I can see where you're coming from.
I think that I'm learning that God is not social distancing from us, even if we have to social distance from each other. I mean, I don't want to be anywhere near anyone else right now because germs, but God doesn't feel that way. He's with us even when we're alone. He cares about us and he's close behind us, beside us. I think that's one of the best parts about God. That humans just can't replicate. And when God's with us, he can give us comfort, his love, his hope, and his healing.
You took the words right out of my mouth. God is doing great things. He is not caught up in the rules that we live by. He is free to help families connect, heal the environment, and remind us what living is all about.
Me, I guess it's good to know that God shares with me in my sadness. He weeps with me as I go through this time. And the Bible says he gathers all of our tears in a bottle. It must be a big bottle. I'm glad God can share in my sufferings. It helps me know I'm loved.
Well, for me, like, the theological questions are really hard questions because, like, for me, like, I just really want to freak out and, like, just get all the information that I need from God. I want all the details of, like, what will happen next with me. The virus and all this crazy stuff going on, but I know that God knows all these details, but he only really lets us know what we need to know at the time. And I know that I need to learn to, like, trust him, and to trust that he has everything under control. I think I need to learn to trust that God is doing good things even in this hard time, and no matter what happens, that, you know, God hears my prayers and he cares for me. And I have to step out of my natural, you know, inclination, which is just to freak out and just to learn to trust him and live by faith. Yes. Yeah. And I'm trying to learn to do this, and I'm finding that, you know, God is faithful and can be trusted. Yeah. So even though it's a bit tricky, I'm getting there. I'm getting there, and I'm freaking out a lot less lately.
Wow. Thank you, everyone, for sharing. Thank you, especially for you, for being so honest with us. We're out of time now, but I'm really encouraged by all the different expressions of emotion that are going on during this time. And I know lots of our viewers would also be having lots of emotion. And the great reminder is that God is with us, and we can connect with each other to make sure we share the burden. Well, thanks so much. It's great to have you all, and we'll catch you next time on Good Morning Barania. Bye.
Bye.
Bye, everyone. Bye.
Open up my
Good morning. Welcome to church this morning. It's great to be with you again and great to share God's word with you. Really looking forward to opening up a new topic where we're going to follow the course of the wilderness or the exile because, you know, that's the season we feel that we're in and we really believe there's something in this space for us. So let's open with a word of prayer. Father, we're so grateful to be together again around your word. And although we're not together in one room, we know as a church we are gathering around your word, we're learning, we're seeking, we're looking to you to continue to grow, continue to gain your wisdom from your word. And so we invite your Holy Spirit presence to again come and form our hearts. We invite you to take residence up within us afresh. And God, just give us the capacity to tune in and focus on what you want to say and the still small voice of your spirit that might be at work within us today. We offer this time to you and we pray, God, that in it you would be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, it's wonderful to be with you and wonderful to open up this next series. As we're beginning to prepare post-Easter, we started to think, well, what is God having us to speak about? What in this season might he want us to learn together as a church? And the idea of the wilderness or exile came up as a bit of a topic, and we realised and observed that the whole scripture is full of stories of wilderness and stories of exile. And the scriptures interact with this idea of the desert or the wilderness or exile or prison over and over again from the very beginning of the scriptures all the way through. So we find at the beginning someone like Abraham who is sent out to a land he doesn't know, out of his homeland. We have people like Noah who takes exile in a boat to remain safe. We have stories of Joseph, Moses, the children of Israel. We have the judges and the rise and the fall of Israel, depending on who's leading, and the invasion of other lands of Israel when they're not following God's teaching. And then we come post the split kingdom and we find that again we have prophets after prophet warning that exile will come if Israel don't stop pursuing other gods and turn their hearts back to God. And then we have in exile prophets like Daniel, people like Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego, people like Esther, great King David back in the earlier stories. All of these people faced exiles or faced wilderness challenges. And then if we move into the New Testament, we come across a scruffy prophet named John who's in the wilderness calling the people to repent. And very soon after, Jesus himself enters the stage and has his own wilderness experience. The apostles don't get off the hook and they are exiled, they are martyred and they are persecuted. So all the way through the scriptures and indeed church history, if we were to go on and look, we would find that there is an element of wilderness or an element of exile. What our theologians like to call disorientation, where people come out of the space that they're oriented with and comfortable with, and they move into a space where they have no control or knowledge of what to do or how to do things, and they have to find their way in the midst of disorientation. And it's wonderful that the scriptures have these kind of stories in them, because in actual fact, they help reveal to us who are living in a very similar disorientation space that God is able to do something in these spaces. I mean, the temptation is for us to pull up stumps in a time like this and think maybe God's given up. But if we look at the story of Scripture, what we'll find is that God is active and at work within the spaces of wilderness or within the spaces of disorientation. And so we can be really grateful that actually God is doing something in that kind of space. Because that's the space truly we're in. And let me pause for a moment. I think you've probably heard this sentence like me hundreds of times. We are living in unprecedented times. And we find ourselves in this wilderness. We don't know what's going to happen. We don't know what the final impact would be. Thankfully, our country is much safer than many, many other countries, but yet we see that we're in a space where so much of our life has been altered and we're grieving and missing the things, the familiar things, the things that we love, the people that we love. And the longer this goes on, the more the impact kind of starts to catch up with us, whether it's financial or whether it's relational, whether it's our sense of being able to exercise and work and practice our skills. All of these things, as time goes on and it turns out not to be just a two-week shutdown, we begin to feel the sense of disorientation and wilderness. And it's not helpful when Christians pull out a cliche from their bag and say, well, let go and let God. As if the words will magic away somehow the problem and the tension and the struggle and the disorientation that we're feeling. We don't want words to placate us. What we want in a time like this is for God to show up, for God to engage, for God to powerfully and miraculously birth his purposes and plans. And the good news is that that's exactly what the scriptures tell us God does. He does show up in these times. In fact, if you like to have a think about it, it's these kind of times that are the stories we tell. I mean, it takes a giant for a shepherd boy to become a giant slayer. It takes a battle for God to overcome an enemy army for his glory. It takes famine for Joseph to bring wisdom to Egypt. It takes the struggles. It takes the difficulties. It takes those tough times for God to bring the breakthrough. And we know this. We understand that actually God is doing something often in those places. We look across the world and we see the persecuted church and we say, maybe that's why they see the miraculous. Maybe that's why they're growing so much. Yeah, probably it is. But we don't pray for persecution and we don't ask God for struggles and we don't press in on this kind of stuff because none of us really want those prayers to be answered. We pray prayers for comfort. We pray well, I do. I don't know about you, but I pray that God will take care of people, that things will run smoothly, that there'll be peace and that my home will be all well in my household. I don't pray for persecution. I don't pray for hard times, and I don't pray that God will take me into a wilderness. And perhaps that's an interesting thought for us to pause on, but let's not stop there too long. The reality is, in this case, we didn't have to pray for a wilderness. We find ourselves here anyway. And without having to pray for it, and without having to risk ourselves in that space, God has actually taken us into a space where we know the miraculous, the good, the work, the deep transformation takes place. And he is promising he will do that work. And so we hope over the next few weeks that as we engage with this topic of the wilderness, that what we will do is equip us as a church to take on our backpack. And I brought a backpack here. This isn't mine because I haven't hiked for about 30 years. This is Paul's backpack. He likes to hike. And he does 20k hikes and puts his tent and everything in it. But I brought it as a bit of a symbol of the wilderness. The backpack, you know, you can take a lot in it. And if you're short on stuff, if you've got a backpack, you're going to be okay. And we're going to talk each week about the tools that we needed to tuck into our backpack to help us as we travel through the wilderness. So we're going to begin this journey by reading from Genesis chapter 12, in the beginning of the Israel story. And I'm going to begin at verse 1, and you can just track along with me. The Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. And I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you, and I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. Whoever curses you, I will curse. And all the peoples of the earth will be blessed through you." So Abram went, and the Lord told him to take Lot. And Abram was 75 years old when he set out for Haran. He took his wife Sarah, his nephew Lot, and all the possessions that he had accumulated and the people he had acquired, and he set out for a land of Canaan, and they arrived there. This story is a story of disorientation, a story of Abraham who had a life, 75 years old, had a wife, had the care of his stepson, his godson, Lot. And in the middle of a life that was quite successful and going very well, God interrupts and he invites Abram out into the wilderness to a place he doesn't know. If we look into Hebrews chapter 11, Hebrews gives us a bit more of a fill out. This was a space that Abram had no idea where he was going. He had no promises of what it would look like or brochures. He didn't have a report back from somebody about what Canaan was like. He just simply stepped out and trusted God into the unknown. If you've got children that like the movie Frozen, you may well have that song, Into the Unknown, stuck in your head for the next day. But let it be a little echo, this little reminder of what Abraham's invitation was, into the unknown. And in a sense, there is something really wonderful about this story because it correlates with our story around the unknown. We are living in a time of the unknown. We don't know what will happen next. We don't know when schools will open. We don't know when our churches will be able to open again. We don't know when or if we'll go back to work for some people. We don't know who will make it through this tough time. And it is a very unknown kind of space. And we rely on our governments and we rely on people that know something more than us to kind of tell us and guide us along the way. But in a sense, we find ourselves in the same space as Abraham. Abraham only knew God. And he trusted God in that space. And of all of the things he'd put his trust in, he considered God was the best option he had. And in a sense, the invitation for us in this season is to fix our eyes in trust on God. You see, God is not like our government or like our neighbours or like our Facebook friends in suggesting what might possibly happen. The scripture tells us God knows the end from the beginning. It's not unknown to God. He knows how these things will play out. And he invites us to trust him in this journey. And as we trust him in this journey, he will lead us through it. So God says to Abram, get up and go to a place I will show you. And Abram gets up and trusts God and goes to the place that God shows him. And the shortness of that story could easily be read over and missed in the magnitude of what that means. But just for a moment, I want to ask you, if God told you to do something, would you do it? Would you get up? Would you go? Would you obediently trust God even if you didn't know where you were going? The story reads us, and in some ways it reads us in this situation, because the invitation is, in the unknown now, can we trust God? So I want to talk about three ways that we can trust God in this season. I'm going to try and be quick and efficient, but I don't want to brush over this, because the idea of trusting God can become a casual conversation. Oh, you've just got to trust God. But trust isn't casual. Abram's trust wasn't casual. And so as we talk about trust today, I want to invite you to pause in and press into this idea of what does it mean to trust. So the first thing that Abram does is he trusts God's word. God makes a promise to Abram. He says, go to a land I will take you and I will bless you. And he pronounces this beautiful blessing over Abram, which we know all these thousands of years later continues to take place. All of the nations of the earth continue to be blessed by the seed of Abraham, the great nation, and the Messiah, Jesus, who came through him. But Abram didn't know that. He didn't know what would happen, and he couldn't see the other side, even of the wilderness, let alone of his story. But still he trusted God's promise. The words God spoke, he trusted. And that made a difference. He knew that God's words weren't just words, but that God had the power to back up his words. And I think there's something really important about that. I use Google Maps quite a bit. I don't know if anybody else does. Once I used to use a Malways, But I don't need a Malways anymore because I have Google Maps and she tells me where to go on a regular basis. And, you know, I trust Google Maps. And most of the time, she gets me to where I want to be, she tells me when to stop, and I park outside the place I'm going. She is amazing. Every now and then she messes it up, and it breaks my trust a little bit with Google Maps, I have to say, and I get a little bit shirty, and I tell her, you're wrong, and be quiet, and stop talking, and we have a bit of a fight until I can get past the traffic challenge that Google doesn't understand exists, and then we get on the same page again. But I think a map is a really helpful example for us around thinking about God's word. I mean, we often will say that the scriptures, God's word is a map for our lives. We find his wisdom in it. We find his words in it. We find his promises in it. And there we're able to map our way, trusting in the words that he says as he gives us direction. And so I'm going to just put my map in my backpack over here. Oh dear, I better do a good job or it will fall out and I'll get lost. There it goes, into the backpack. Because we need to have God's word with us. You know, it makes me think about a story of Jesus in the New Testament where he really hung on God's word. There's no doubt Jesus knew God's words, knew God's promises and trusted them. In fact, he said, everything I do, I only ever do if God tells me to do it. So Jesus built his life on the words of the Father. Never more important, however, were those words perhaps than when he too had a wilderness experience. The Holy Spirit, after Jesus was baptized, took Jesus into the wilderness, the scriptures say. I don't know whether we think that's fair or not, but anyway, that's what the scriptures say. Not because Jesus had done something wrong. It wasn't a punishment that he was in the wilderness, but it was an invitation to come away with Father God and to learn. And so Jesus had been baptized and then was whisked into the desert. And there in the desert, he fasted and prayed. It was a time of special intimacy. But at the end of that time, the scripture says he was hungry. And I don't know whether you ever feel hungry. I don't often feel hungry because I'm keep topped up along the way and I'm not often struggling for food. But I know that when you come across a man who is hungry, they're vulnerable. They're never as strong when they're hungry as when they're full. And I'm pretty sure when the scripture says Jesus was hungry, it meant he was vulnerable. And so there is Jesus at the end of fasting, at the end of praying, at the end of this wilderness time of identity forming and the challenge and the wrestle of knowing who he is with God, and the devil comes along and tempts him, kicks him while he's down, while he's vulnerable. He comes after him and he asks three questions that probably wouldn't tempt me. I remember reading the temptation passages when I was a kid and I thought to myself, gosh, how is that temptation, you know? I turn these stones into bread, or throw yourself off this mountain, or just bow down to me. It's like, they're not difficult temptations. But in actual fact, these were real temptations for Jesus because they were a way for him to gain the whole world and not have to die and suffer on the cross. And so for Jesus, these were very real temptations. But the sentences began with, if you are the Son of God. And really the devil wasn't just going after the temptation of the thing, but he was actually going after the core identity of who Jesus was. And Jesus in that space, in that vulnerability, in that space of hunger and weariness, is hearing this message. If God really loves you, if you really belong to God, I don't know if you've ever heard that nasty whisper in the dark night of your soul, but that is a place of serious vulnerability. And Jesus drew really heavily on the words that Father had said to him before he went into the wilderness. You see, at his baptism, as he was baptized, the Spirit descended from heaven and a voice from heaven said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I love." This incredible and powerful sentence was the word of God that Jesus held on to as the enemy came at his vulnerabilities. And it speaks to us about the necessity of hanging on and having with us through the wilderness God's word, God's promises, God's truth, rather than the words of the world or the ideas that come from others or the fear that maybe even comes from the enemy himself in the dark night of the soul. And some of us need to hang on to what God says about us, not what everybody else says. And we need to get the word of God clear, his promises, his words over us, and we need to trust them. And we need to hang on to them. And we need to not let anybody question them. You are a child of God. You have been adopted into his family. There is no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. You've been seated in heavenly places with God. Check out Ephesians chapter 2 if you want to have a look at just some of the things that are words of promise over your life as a child of God. But can I encourage you, get the word and hang on to the promises in it. The second thing we want to look at tonight is that we want to look at God's works. Abraham trusted not only God's words, but that God was able not just to say things, but actually to make them happen. God had the power to bring about the things that he promised. And Abraham, in a sense, started to see the world as God saw it. It was already done if God said it. And Abram trusted God's works. I don't know how Abram got this sense of trust. I don't know where he built it from. I don't know if he had a visit from angels or whether he had a whole bunch of visions, or I don't know what happened before that call of Abram. But I do know that he was convinced that God was God and that he would and could see through what he had promised. As I said before, we've got to learn to trust God, to put our trust in him, not in a casual sense, but actually to trust that he can deliver and he will deliver what he promises. Sometimes I think in the West, because we don't really press into God and we don't rely on him with much dependence because we are so self-reliant and we can take care of our own needs so very often, we actually fail to see God at work. We don't pray for big stuff. We don't take risks in asking God for stuff out of desperation. And as a result, we don't see God answer our prayers. And maybe that builds a foundation where we're actually too afraid to trust God for anything when we're praying for it. John 15 tells us if we abide in Christ, in God, and if his word abides in us, we can ask anything and it'll be done. You see, when we know who God is, when we trust his promises, and we step into believing who he is, then God is able and will produce answers to our prayers. He will meet our needs. He will do more than we ask or imagine. Sometimes we've got to remind ourselves of who we are and whose we are and the power that God has had. We've got scriptures that tell us of the amazing, miraculous stories that God has always been involved in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. And God has not stopped doing the miraculous. He's not held his hands off the earth and said, well, I think I'm done now that Jesus has died. In fact, God continues to participate with us and answer our prayers as we depend and trust in him. So again, when we see across the globe God doing the miraculous for the churches across the globe, we are reminded we must trust God's works. We need to read those stories. We need to remind ourselves who we are. We need to remember what God is doing and learn and trust that instead of listening to all of the other voices in our world that maybe want to put God's miraculous and powerful person into a myth box. That's what the world wants to do, to take away God's power by shoving him into myth. But that is not the God that we have in the scripture. And so as we trust, we need to trust his works. We need to see the world as he sees it. We need to trust that even though we can't see it, it exists and it's real. So let's put these in our backpack. Finally, we need to trust God's ways. You know what Abraham did? Abraham obeyed God. God said, go, follow me, I'll take you. And Abraham said, okay. And he went God's ways. And he left behind the things that God said leave behind. Leave your family, leave your city, leave your foreign gods, leave your practices, leave your Christmas gathering. I don't know if he left his Christmas gathering, but, you know, leave it all behind and come with me. I have something new for you. I've got a new way of living. I've got a new life. I've got a new plan. I've got something for you that if you keep living in that space, you're never going to achieve. But if you're willing to walk in my ways, if you're willing to obey my teachings, if you're willing to follow my lead, then you will experience my ways, my will, my plan, my new. And this is the kind of way Abram lived, obediently. And this is the invitation we're called to, obedience. It's not a word we use very often in our liberated society. We don't try and tell people what to do and expect them to obey, except perhaps our children. But, you know, in general, in society, we're even before telling people what to do, we're inviting them. Would you like to come and sit at the table or set the table? We don't like to tell people what to do in our country. And so we probably balk a little bit at this word obedience. But the word simply means not that we're doing something out of religion to tick off the boxes, but that we are stepping in trust at what God says, and knowing that he knows what is best, and we are practicing his way of living instead of our own. And some of us probably have a whole bunch of things we could leave behind, really. Vices, attitudes, practices, habits, behaviours. And maybe that's the stuff God is calling us out of. And maybe this is the season when there's kind of a break in all of that, that we're actually free to never go back. And then there's probably a whole bunch of us that have been called into new practices. Maybe God's calling you to get up and pray for an hour, like Alf from Bayswater does every day. Maybe he's saying, don't just write a list. Light a candle, get a journal, draw near, open the word, put on music. Come to me. Maybe he's inviting you to get healthy. Maybe he's inviting you to study the scripture, get to know it, get to know him from the end of both ends of the scripture and really capture his heart. You see, God is inviting us to obedience, to practice his way of living, to let go of the idea that perhaps we know how to rule our world best, and to trust him, even in the simple things. And in doing so, to learn and to discover the freedom and the new life that he has for us. So new ways, new practices, God's way, what God has provided for us. That's what he's inviting us to take in obedience. I don't like to drink water. I like to drink coffee. But I believe God is inviting me to drink water. It's a new practice. But the metaphor is there, isn't it? It's life-giving, it's cleansing, it's healthy, it's well-being. And I believe that's the invitation to obedience. So, my friends, I hope you have a great opportunity to reflect on this, to reflect on your own wilderness and what's happening for you, and then to be able to apply God's word, God's works and God's ways into your life this week, and to take the opportunity to let this wilderness be a place that forms you. So let's pray. Lord, we just so thank you that your word is speaking to us. Even though it was written so long ago, it still has words of life for us. It still teaches us how to know you and how to live life abundantly. And so we just want to take into ourselves these instructions and encouragements, and we want to leave them out in a way, God, that brings glory to you, that brings us closer in relationship to you, and that enables us, Lord, to live a fulfilled life that brings glory to your name. So, Lord, would you bless us and keep us? Would you make your face shine upon us and be gracious unto us in our going out? No, in our staying in our labour, our leisure, our laughter and our tears. And would you give us the courage to trust you more this week? In Jesus' name, amen. Well, God bless you. We'll see you next week.